Overhead. Good. My name is Marta Ugas. I'm the EFSA's chief scientist. I'm here today with my colleague, Mike Ashpole, chief scientist of the European Center for Disease Control. And together we'll be chairing this session. And it's my pleasure to welcome you to this session on, that focuses on biological hazards, on threats at the global scale, that considers the challenges that these will pose to risk assessment and also when we need to deliver scientific advice. All these from a One Health perspective. Two topics, vector-borne disease and antimicrobial resistance, will be used to illustrate the challenges ahead. So we aim at these sessions to address several objectives. And also we will explore the opportunities of the new methodologies, such as whole genome sequences, that can help to investigate and disseminate the opportunities and challenges that this methodology can offer to prevent human illness. But we will also try to understand the impact of globalization, assessing risks posed by biological hazards and threats, and also how we can best give advice to risk managers on intervention measures, for example, on the considering the need for ongoing vector surveillance to detect and respond for changes in distribution and emergence of new vector-related issues, and also to discuss a bit the epidemiology of antimicrobial resistance in bacteria causing foodborne illnesses, and the role of the environment in the spread of this antimicrobial resistant genes. So I will now pass the word to my colleague who will introduce the first speaker. Mike, so the word is yours.
Marta, thank you very much. And just to, before we start the session, can I just remind you, very important to remember to switch your phones back on after the session. Our first speaker today is David Waltner-Taves. David's a university professor emeritus at the University of Guelph and also an associate researcher at the Community of Practice for Ecosystem Approaches to Health Canada. He's got an impressive record of publications, textbooks, peer review papers. He's also produced books on poetry and recipes and recently published a book, The Origin of Feces. So I'm sure we're looking forward to a fascinating and excellent talk on SPAM's labyrinth, impact of globalization on foodborne disease. David.
Thank you. I see that it's already counting down. I have two neckties. This one my daughter bought for me. It has avian influenza viruses on it. The other one has sheep on it. They're all white sheep, but there's one black sheep in the middle of it, which my wife assured me that was me. And attending this conference, I feel like I should have worn that one because I feel like a bit of a black sheep here. Before I get right into it, some of you have heard this before, but one of my assumptions is that eating is to the human-environment relationship what sex is between people. You can't get closer to any environment than by taking a piece of that environment, whether it's plant, animal, mineral, putting it into your body, and it becomes part of your body. So if you think about food in that way, then you want to know where have they been before they got to your plate? Who were they with yesterday? Where have they come from? All of the questions you might ask of sexual partners, we should be asking of food partners, and then we get into problems when we look at globalization. A few definitions. Pan's labyrinth, and I'm sorry, I just noticed it just before I came up here, was that I misspelled Guillermo del Toro, the filmmaker who made a film called Pan's Labyrinth, which is this darkly mysterious underworld that lies just below the surface of everyday life. And I tend to think of our food system that way, our agri-food system, certainly globally. If we create misery elsewhere in the world, that misery will come back to us through the labyrinth, land on our plates, enter our bodies, and we become the misery we create elsewhere. Spam is a canned meat. It was initially a marketing solution in looking for a problem. They had a George Hormel in Minnesota. He had some pork shoulder. He didn't know how to market it. He gave it a special name. He had a little contest. Somebody won $100 for naming it Spam. And then they started marketing it. In the Second World War, it became a solution to a problem that he hadn't known was coming, and that is, how do you feed soldiers overseas with a canned product that's essentially bacteriologically safe? In modern times, affordability, accessibility, extended shelf life make it a stand-in, for me at least, for any modern globally distributed generic food, Spam. It's also unwanted emails that one gets. And there's a Monty Python skit and a whole song that goes, spam, 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 spam. If you've watched it, it's very annoying. What does this look like? Well, this is based on scientific studies. And you look at this and you go, okay, this is a kind of labyrinth. This is international agro-food trade networks. And it's in an article on its impact on food safety. I look at that and say, okay, what do we do with this? Not sure. We go to the next slide is what we do there. So is there an impact of this? As an epidemiologist, we have the usual suspects. We look at case studies, and I'll talk a little bit about those. We used to do something called population attributable fraction. What is the fraction of the disease in the population that could be attributed to this? We talk about globalization and foodborne disease. This is an impossible task with a lot too many wild guesses. We can look at before and after trends. What were foodborne diseases like before globalization? What are they like afterwards? Lots of problems with that, but we'll look at that a little bit. We've talked a bit about risk analysis in the last day or so, and I want to revisit that in a context of globalization, and then look a little bit at complex systems and what that might tell us, and then go from there. What do we learn from case studies? There are a lot of case studies. I began working on this by looking at Salmonella agona in Lactalis. We have the infant formula produced in France and various other places, distributed to 83 countries. The Shigatoxin producing E. coli in fenugreek seeds, which was eventually traced back probably to a place in Egypt. If I go back to my teaching days, cyclospora in raspberries and other fresh produce from Central America. And if you go back even further to the late 1980s, there were outbreaks of staphylococcal food poisoning in the U.S. from canned mushrooms in China. And that was related to shifting trade barriers and the way that the foods were canned and shipped within China. So you had a trade change and regulation change in China that resulted in staph toxin in canned foods, which was not expected in the United States. So what lessons do we learn? Well, in a rapidly changing social and ecological context, outbreaks will always be surprises, and we can expect them. So that's kind of a contradiction there, but we can expect there to be outbreaks, and they will always catch us off guard. It's not the volume of trade. If you look at that trade diagram, you have volumes of trade. For the most part, the outbreaks we've seen don't have to do with volume. They have to do with particular ingredients from particular places that find their way through this labyrinth into our food system. If some of these diseases come through because they're endemic in the producing company, they can be best addressed by improving social, economic, and ecological conditions in those countries. Better healthcare, better water, better food supply. We almost never do that. We want to trace back and we want to do some industrial control from this end. That's at best a short-term solution, and it often has huge negative consequences and will keep getting us caught off guard. The distribution networks can be addressed by looking at issues of local democracy and distributed knowledge, more engagement with different publics, but they're almost always addressed by centralizing power and control. So we take HACCP analysis from a factory, we expand it to a community, and we try to expand it to a world. Well, if you have critical control points, that assumes somebody's controlling them. Who's controlling them? It's usually some multinational corporation. What do we do with that? If we look at temporal trends, which was one of the things that I mentioned, this is Salmonella typhoid. You can see it dropped at the beginning of the 20th century and kept dropping. And that was most often waterborne, and water has tended until recently not to be globalized. I mean, now we get bottles of water in Canada, which are apparently from fresh Italian places that are cleaner than the water we have, which I have trouble believing, but anyway. So now we're seeing that, and that has other kinds of foodborne disease problems. Non-typhoidal salmonella has increased dramatically during the same time as we've had globalization, which was more or less during the 1980s, if you look at the way things were expanded in terms of food production. The risk analysis model that I grew up with, that I was trained in the 1970s and 80s and 90s, was actually a three-stage model, then they condensed it to two stages, where you have the scientific part, where that's the risk assessment, and then you have management and communication. As we've seen the last few days, that's problematic, and it's even more problematic if we go to globalization. Even when we focus on that narrow risk assessment, there are so many value judgments that are made. We've talked about those in the last day or so, choice of type 1, type 2 errors, which species we measure, what kind of levels we measure, what kind of tests we use, all of those kind of things. Those are not scientific decisions, those are before you do the science, you're deciding what things do we think are important. When we apply these to longer time frames and a globally heterogeneous, rapidly changing political and agricultural landscape, these problems just multiply exponentially. So it's one problem if you're doing it within a country or within the EU. If you start talking about multi-countries, if you're talking about China and Ghana and Germany and United States, suddenly this becomes a near impossible task. And one of my colleagues, Conrad Brunk, who worked with the Codex people and with the Canadian government on looking at trying to tease apart these, he looked at a non-linear conception of risk. I don't expect you to look at all of them, but in the bottom right-hand corner, from your point of view, the distribution of the hazards is changes when we look globally. I mean, it's already apparent when we look within a country, but who produces the risk? Who benefits from having taken that risk? And it's usually totally different. Even within a country, you look globally, we in Europe or in North America might benefit from risks that are taken by farmers in China and sub-Saharan Africa. And that's a huge issue when we're looking at risk management. So the answer, and this is from peer-reviewed literature, does globalization have an impact on foodborne disease? Maybe. And I guess I could stop the talk there, but I decided to explore this a little bit further. Where does this leave us now? How we respond to this maybe is very likely to have a huge impact on foodborne diseases, and not necessarily in a positive way. So I'm going to put this into a health context. These are my four grandchildren here. The one in the little bee suit is my granddaughter, who's learning how to raise bees in South Australia. You can't tell that that's her. So when I think of health, I think of them, but I also think of some other things. This is the WHO definition of health, a complete physical, mental, and social well-being, and not merely the absence of disease or infirmity. It's very nice. It's like an orgasm. You pass through it. It was very, but it's not a sustainable state, right? I suppose you could have policies that promote, you know, optimum number of orgasms over a lifetime, but that's not usually what we mean by health. I prefer this one from René Dubos, the microbiologist. It's a modus vivendi enabling imperfect people to achieve a rewarding and not too painful existence while they cope with an imperfect world. To me, that's a workable definition. And I think of health as three Fs. I'll reduce it down to this, simplify things. So one is food, okay? And if you look at what's happened with food supplies in the 20th century and into this century, that's been a success. Lots of meat, milk, eggs. If you look at plant-based foods, they've also gone up to that level. Freedom from disease, the second F. And if you look in general, there are always exceptions to this. Infectious diseases have generally dropped globally. So from that point of view, pretty successful. There are some remaining pockets of disease problems, malaria and things like that, but in general, things have been getting better. The question comes then, how did we achieve this? There's a kind of once upon a time story. Henry IV of France in about 1600 said, if God keeps me, I will make sure that no peasant in my realm will lack the means. He didn't say they would have a chicken in every pot, but they would have the means, so the increase of income, not necessarily increase in the number of chickens, in a pot on every Sunday. Unfortunately, he was assassinated shortly after that by a religious zealot, so God maybe was ambiguous about this this story. How did we achieve it? Well, one of them was efficiency. Highly automated, efficient, targeted to specific clients. In North America, KFC requires a 1.7 kilogram water-chilled chicken. Swiss Chalet requires a 2.4 kilogram air-chilled chicken. And farmers can raise those. We've got the genetics, we've got the feed, we've got the lighting, all of those kind of things. Intensive recycling. This is just tankage, so meat and boat meal. Exports from the United States during a certain time period. And you can see, Indonesia was getting $120 million worth of meat and bone meal. What are they doing with this? Well, they're feeding it to chickens and fish, and perhaps they're exporting it back over here. So this is kind of ecologically, is this a good thing? I don't know. You have to pay attention to certain things if you're going to do that kind of recycling, and I'll come back to that. Economies of scale. And in chickens, it really only became possible when lab scientists could synthesize vitamin D. Because otherwise, for egg laying particularly, they needed to be outside to get their vitamin D. 1930s, 1940s, they identified what vitamin D was. They learned how to synthesize it. They could put it into chicken feed and move the chickens inside, and then you can go to economies of scale. And this is a chicken barn in southern Ontario. It's actually a turkey barn, it looks like to me, but it's a poultry barn. Same general idea. And huge social changes. This goes back to probably the 1930s. It was the last time when you could see the farmer, the processor, and the animal rights activist in the same picture. You don't get them in the same picture anymore, right? You want a selfie, you gotta go to separate rooms, separate conferences. So we have all of these social, technological changes, unexpected outcomes, and problematic successes. So efficient recycling, one of the outcomes was the BSE epidemic. So you have very efficient recycling of proteins within a system. It's going back. This is good stuff, right? It's ecologically efficient. But there are other things besides the meat and bone meal that are getting recycled. And the distribution of pathogens. If you look at the rates of foodborne disease during that time, they all looked like they were going up post-globalization. So since the 70s and 80s. Is this a real thing? Is this just a heuristic? We're not sure. And world excrement production, which a lot of people don't pay attention to, but I studied it for a book called The Origin of Feces. We now produce about 14 billion tons of excrement every year, us and our livestock produce this much excrement. And that's a problem, right? Because we're drawing nutrients from some parts of the world and we're dumping them in other parts of the world, so we're depleting some environments and over-enriching others. This is a success story, but it's also a problem, right? We have more people, so more people living longer, more surviving. That's why I call it a problematic success. Population control didn't used to be an issue. It became an issue after we had this production of food. So the third F, some of you might have thought you knew what the third F was. This is actually what I think of as, we might call them the social determinants of disease, our friends. The consequences of not asking who we and the people are when we talk about we can feed the world. Who are we? And what's the world we're trying to feed? If we don't pay attention to those economic, social dynamics, we end up with these kinds of divergence between the wealthy and the poor. And that is a problem. The other thing that happens is with this linear narrative, we blame individual consumers, so he didn't wash his hands, right? That's the problem. The consumer didn't wash their hands, they didn't cook, they didn't clean the counter. Or we blame the individual corporation. In this case, it was, you know, is your washroom breeding Bolsheviks? That was an attempt by Scott Tissue to encourage factories to use tissues in the bathroom so that the workers would feel comfortable and be clean and not be disgruntled and start unions and overthrow the government. But it also ends up with Monsanto versus a farmer in a courtroom. So it's not the structure that's an issue, it's this company, this farmer, this chemical. And that's a natural consequence of having told this kind of a linear story. So is this the right question? How on earth can we feed 8 billion people? Is that the right question? Who are we? Who are the people? When people say that, they often say, they have this idea that there's this agency, company, whatever, and the rest of us are lined up outside there with our mouths open and we're being fed. Anybody who's been in the real world knows that that's not actually how things work. Another way to come at this is using complex systems, and I've worked with that over many years. So you have all these interactions, like that trade thing, except there's more stuff, right? So you have infrastructure, economy and wealth, business and trade, health and well-being, ecosystem services, water availability. And that's when I've worked with students and we actually draw these, it's useful to draw them, the process is, but in the end you just become paralyzed. Anything you do will have unintended consequences, so why would you even bother? It's a problem. If you stand back and look at the whole system, systems have certain kinds of behavior. So if we look at foodborne diseases since the 1990s, so it's kind of after globalization, they've more or less stabilized, except for Vibrio, which is an interesting case there, because Vibrio tends to be, at least historically, waterborne, and so you have some difference going on there, but it seems relatively stable since then. We like to take credit because we think it's all of the infrastructure and food safety programs. I'm sure that's had some impact, but another way to look at it is to use René Thom's catastrophe theory to look at complex systems. So you have increased globalization and you have low foodborne disease rates. And at some point the system flips over and then you have high foodborne disease rates. So this is one way to describe it. The challenge when we've looked at other ecosystems, the Great Lakes and so on, to get back to the low system, you essentially have to go through a creative destruction crash and reinvent the system again. I mean, that's in a sense what happened in the Great Lakes. I'm not sure people within EFSA really want to crash the system and start over again. So this is a challenge if this is what's happening. If we are now in a food system where high foodborne disease rates are just, that's part of the system. You want to have this level of food, this kind of globalization, then we just have to deal with having this level of foodborne disease. It's part of it. We've learned to live with salmonella and chicken. Maybe we can learn to live with a little bit of salmonella and everything. If we go to beyond that kind of model and we look at the kind of unstable transitions we're in that Silvio talked about the first day, where this interregnum between the collapse perhaps of an old one and the reinvention of a new system. And I've looked at this, I've looked at chickens and different kind of nuts, almonds and Brazil nuts, insects, soybeans, GMOs, economies of scale, industrialization of meat, excrement. You pick your interest of concern. If you look at the evidence that it's probably the cause of the world's worst environmental problems. They're major drivers of emerging diseases. It's the best solution to protein insufficiency. There's evidence for all of these. It's a way out of poverty for women in southern countries. It's a way to improve childhood learning. You give them meat protein supplements, they learn better in school. Is this a bad thing? No, there's good evidence for this. It's a way to enforce patriarchy and gender-based inequity, and I've seen this where you have, you know, women raising chickens in the backyard, you improve the production, the men take over and it becomes a business enterprise where they're making money, and then you have to find something else for the women to grow. Now it's insects. I don't know what it'll be next, but there's this kind of a reinforcement of traditional structures. It's a way to reinforce the power of multinational businesses. And I'll come back to that a little bit. A way to solve social problems with science and technology. What happens is that we have all of these perspectives, and there is legitimate scientific peer-reviewed literature that can support any of these perspectives. Some of them are privileged for reasons of gender, for personal values, for wealth, for sustainability, and you start asking, well, whose evidence matters here? The challenge for policy that I see is that diseases are emerging in this globalized system under circumstances where, as the post-normal scientists like Silvio and Jerry would say, the facts are uncertain, the values are in dispute, the stakes are high, and the decisions are urgent, or at least they appear to be urgent. There are many who come forth and they say, we know how to solve this. We're going to guide you through the labyrinth. We'll get to the other side. Part of the problem here is that we've been so strongly influenced by Marvel Comics that we think that there's going to be some hero come in with a new technology that's going to save us. It's going to go zap, and it's going to save us. That's not going to happen. Well, I don't think it's going to happen. There are many possible responses to globalization and foodborne disease. Some are likely to have larger negative social and ecological impacts than others. And I put in parenthesis there, that's my value judgment. Others might say, well, those changes are not negative. But I happen to value economic equity, gender equity, environmental sustainability, local democracy. Those are not scientific things. Those are things that I value. And so therefore, I choose the perspectives which I think are going to promote that, right? So which perspectives we choose, whether it's we're going to make as much money as possible, we want to have a more equitable system, we want to have more gender equity, we want to have sustainability. Those are things that we choose to do, and then we try to find ways through there. So the task for risk analysts for risk assessment is to work with people who have conflicting goals, unequal power at different temporal and spatial scales, where outcomes and processes need to be continually renegotiated in the context of where everything is changing dynamically. And I was looking at a book the other day by a Canadian, Adam Kahane, who was mentioned in both the Nobel Prize speech of the President of Colombia and by Nelson Mandela from South Africa. He wrote a book called Collaborating with the Enemy, How to Work with People You Don't Agree With or Like, it's not a problem, or Trust, because in these situations people didn't trust each other. And there are ways of working through that, and they're not going to be found in a computer somewhere. And so as a final statement then, I would say to impact the food supply of the world, it's necessary to attend to many different worlds. And Emily Yates Doerr did studies on One Health and insects. And she found that, in fact, the lab people in Wageningen lived in a different world than the people that they were trying to save in Southern Africa or in Southeast Asia. So how do you begin to bring these things together? And it's paying attention to those multiple worlds and negotiating our way through that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, David. If you could keep on the stage, because we do have time for questions. So please, if you have a question, you can either raise your hand or you can post it on the app. Can we see if they've had any questions posed on the app? If we have, if you could put them up on the screen now, I think that would be helpful.
I'm just thinking of an example.
But I do see while we're waiting,
there are some questions.
We have one question. I have a question here from the front. If you could just say who you are and then what your question is, that would be helpful.
Thank you. So I'm Robert Madeline. I work with a firm called FIPRA International in Brussels. And I want to ask you a question about your slide where you say impacts of events will always surprise us and trace back is difficult. Because are we not now, with genotyping beginning to come into a world where trace back is easy, think about some of the listeria outbreaks we've managed recently in Europe. And if that were true, maybe part of the answer to your complexity is insurance and putting stuff back into the system and allowing the system to find the answer, which is an option today and was not at all 50 years ago. So market-based solutions driven by more knowledge and effective traceback.
That's, maybe I used the wrong word on the tracebacks. The tracebacks are problematic in the sense that if you're within a country jurisdiction, and I agree with you that technology is getting better and people are using genomics and they're using, talking about using blockchain and things like that, is that if you have, for instance, critical control points along that way, that assumes that they are in fact control points. And in a globalized system, that's a problem because if the control points might be on a small farm in Southern Africa, they might be in China, they might be somewhere else. If you trace the organisms back to that place, then what more often happens than not is that that individual producer bears the brunt of the cost. When in fact that individual producer is living in a society where they don't have proper healthcare, they don't have proper water. I mean, I saw this with cyclospora where Centers for Disease Control was recommending that Guatemala raspberry producers use potable water for putting pesticides on their raspberries. And I was in Guatemala at the time going, people don't have potable water to drink, regular people. But these exporters are getting this, you know, special treatment if you want because they're generating money and so on. That's what I mean by, I guess the word is problematic. It's not that we can't do it, we can do it better now, which is why we know, you know, we had salmonella outbreaks traced to almonds in California. The reason we know this is because of the genetic fingerprints and so on. But that doesn't address the larger question of why are these occurring in almond orchards in California, for instance. Well, that's because of the way the water laws are constructed there and those kinds of things, and they're driven by human health. People are saying, eat almonds, they're very good for you. They all have all these health benefits. So you have a consumer and a pull, and at the other end, you've got people who control the resources, and then people around them who don't have enough water. So I guess it's more problematic than, it's not that it's not, it's becoming easier, you're right, to trace back. But once you go beyond borders, it becomes problematic to know what to do with that information. And I don't have an answer for that.
Thank you. Do we have other questions from the audience? Yes, we have.
I wonder if you'd like to comment on a recent problem, and that was bovine spongiform encephalopathy, or new variant CJD, which potentially could have killed millions of people. We are very lucky that it didn't, and I wonder how you view that in terms of trying to prevent it in the future, something like that, a prion disease that did actually, instead of only affecting a very few number of people, did actually affect a large section of the population. Because it seems to me there are some worrying things around in the background. And we were very, very lucky that didn't infect large numbers of the population.
And I think, and we've talked about this in this conference already, and I think people are aware of it, is Oliver Sacks, the American clinical neurologist, said that we suffer from a lack of peripheral vision. He was talking actually physically about his peripheral vision, but I think as scientists, we tend to lack that. We focus in, we're very good at focusing in on something, and it might be recycling of protein within the meat slaughtering system and so on. The way we gain as scientists and people working in food safety and so on, we get peripheral vision, is by working with lots of other people who see things differently, who say, you know, you're doing this and this and this, but what about bacteria? What about viruses? What about other things? And it's with BSE, it was problematic because when I went through veterinary school, prions could not possibly cause disease. In fact, they definitively did not cause disease. There was something else, a slow virus or something like this. And then, of course, you know, 20, 30 years later, they probably did cause disease. So our understanding changes and how we manage changes, and I guess that's why I say these are going to be surprises, but we can minimize perhaps how shocking the surprises are by working together with lots of other people and being open to somebody saying, have you thought about this? And instead of saying, well, that's a crazy idea, but you say, well, no, we haven't thought about that. What if we included that in how we looked at this, and that changes the economics of it, and then somebody says, well, it's going to cost more to do this, and say, well, yes, but there are other consequences of not putting that cost into the system. Globalization creates a further problem in that the costs are often offloaded to other countries. So we have, you know, you can have a wonderful, sustainable-looking farm in Sweden, but they're importing soybeans from Brazil and fish meal from the South China Sea or other places. Is that sustainable? Well, it looks nice in the countryside, but it's not a long-term sustainable solution. We've just exported it. There are people now who argue that if we recycle insects locally, the insects eating organic waste from grocery stores, and they grow the larvae on that soldier fly larvae, you dry them and you feed them back to fish and poultry. That might be one, it's a technical solution, but it also has various other kinds of positive benefits. That may be an exception, I don't know, but there are different ways of looking at these issues. And I think keeping our peripheral vision open and saying up front what our values are. You know, if I have a choice between equitably distributed wealth and making lots of money, then I would say, well, I'm happy to pay more taxes in Canada if I see it's worked with equitably. Now, I'm in a privileged position, right? I'm a white guy, post-war period in Canada, so I can say that. And I listen to other people and say, well, you know, we're in business, we're trying to make money. Okay, well, but you're in our society, so let's talk about this. How you can make a living and give people jobs, and somehow or other we come out somewhere that's, you know, a modus vivendi that's not too bad for most people to get through life.
Thank you. I think probably we'll need to move on, but I think you've given us a lot to think about, and I'm sure that some of these issues will come back in the panel discussion that we have at the end of this, but I think for me a key take-home message is it is complex. Risk assessment needs to look at issues beyond those occurring just within your own borders. Anyway, David, thank you very much, and we need to now move on to our second speaker, and it's a pleasure to introduce Dr. Alessandra Caratoli. Alessandra has been a permanent member of staff at the Instituto Superiore di Sanità in Rome since 1997, where currently she's the research director. And from 2013 to 2015, she was the visiting professor at Institute of Infectious Disease at the University of Bern in Switzerland. She's got an impressive publication history and has been the recipient of many awards and was the inventor of the PCR-based replicon typing plasmid MLST and the author of the Plasmid Finder database. So, welcome.
Okay, welcome to your molecular microbiology class. I will kill you with genes, names, no, so don't worry. But it's true that this is an evidence-based talk. So we will talk of molecules, because molecules are at the origin of the problem of antimicrobial resistance. If I do it, well, yes. So a nomenclature list. What is a resistant gene? A resistant gene is a gene that confers to a bacterial host the capacity to survive to a drug. And we have two kinds of resistant genes. One is simply a mutation that occurs within the target of the antibiotic. The other, for me much more interesting, is an acquired resistant gene. Means something like an enzyme, well done, and that bacterium just need to meet, to take, and to express. And that's it's how can I say easier than to find a mutation in a gene target, because you know mutations sometimes are in essential genes, so they have a cost. Not always they are so efficient in conferring resistance. They were playing an important role in conferring resistance to certain class of antimicrobials, but not all. In gram negatives, especially, I will show you, the problem is acquired resistant genes. And a gene is nothing, is a piece of DNA, if it's not expressed and replicate. And we have molecules like this one, transposon, that express the genes and mobilize the genes from a piece of DNA to another piece of DNA. And we have plasmids that can offer to the resistant gene a well way of transmission, that is a sexual transmission. So one of the most efficient in every kingdom, also in the prokaryotic kingdom, because they promote the conjugation, the sex between bacteria, so plasmids offer to the resistant gene this opportunity to be transmitted by sex. Oops, sorry. Just to give you another thought, an acquired resistant gene can be transmitted through the horizontal gene transfer. It means that you can see this gene moving from different bacteria. A mutation occurring in the target gene can be transmitted only vertically from the cell to the daughter cells during the cell division. So the fate, the destiny of an acquired resistant gene for us has a completely different impact. We can see these genes moving from different bacteria, even jumping the genera barrier. Three major problems occurred in food. We are here for food, so we don't talk of the of other kinds of resistance. I concentrated on resistant genes that really played an important role in food producing animals, and of course in humans. And these are very popular. One is the transmission of resistance to third generation cephalosporins. The second is the resistance to colistin, and the third is the resistance to the last generation beta lactams, the carbapenems. There are three different stories at the molecular level that could be interesting for you as an example of what we study and how science can give some information to the risk analysis on what is going on into a bacterium that show a particular resistance instead of another one. So starting with SBL and MC, what does it mean SBL? Extended spectrum beta-lactamases. These enzymes are encoded by genes, mobile genes, and gave a lot of problems, yes. And MC is another kind of genes, but more or less they confer resistance to important clinically relevant beta-lactams. Every enzyme has its activity, so there are enzymes that are able to hydrolyze very narrow beta-lactams, and there are enzymes that are able to work on new generation cephalosporins or even carbapenems. So it's very important to know which gene are you studying, because not all the genes gives all the resistance to everything, okay? So if we take in consideration only the extended spectrum beta-lactamase, we don't care of some resistance against, I don't know, clavulanic acid, because they don't confer resistance to clavulanic acid and amoxicillin. So in 2013, I was part of a panel here at the EFSA here, and with Ernesto Liebana and other colleagues, we evaluated the risk of enterobacterial isolates producing extended spectrum beta-lactamase MC genes in food-producing animals, and we gave an epidemiological view, evidence-based. We studied all the literature describing at that moment the situation. And we detected some relevant high-risk clones that were linked to food, and here are listed the E. coli serotype involved and Salmonella serovirus involved. We also saw that there were some predominant genes that were in this kind of bacteria. And at the time, we established, for instance, the, priority risk with respect to different genes that were described in the literature. And then there were a lot of studies also on the human side, and you see there is an unequal distribution of genes in the world. For instance, these are the extended spectrum beta-lactamase CTXM, and you see there are some that are more popular in the north of the planet, others that are unique of the south of the planet. So there is a geographical distribution of some variants, and so it's interesting to know how the same gene has traveled, for instance, from United States to Europe and vice versa. The question is, if I have the same gene everywhere, how is this gene being transmitted? Is the same bacterium, is the same plasmid, is only the same gene? So we can have different level of investigation to explain the globalization. You see, five enzymes justify more or less 90% of the standard spectrum beta-lactamase on the planet. It came the genomic area. So we had very, very accurate analysis of bacteria. We investigated the continent, all the genes continent, all the plasmid continent. This helped a lot. And also bacterial typing and plasmid typing evolved. So now we have very accurate evidence that we can see what is inside a cell coming from food to compare it with a cell coming from a human being. We cannot be mistaken because we read the entire sequence of the bacterium. So we know exactly if these two things are related or not. And we developed a scheme and a database for plasmids. So in this database that is hosted in the same pages of the genome of the bacterial MLST. MLST is multi-locus sequence type. It's a molecular method to type bacteria. We adopted for plasmids. That was very useful because now we have 1,500 records of plasmids that have been submitted to this database with some epidemiological information regarding the beta-lactams on it, the source isolation, the country isolation, the year of isolation. So finally, we have some molecular evidence that has been translated to an epidemiological database. And in this database, you see we have some plasmids that are epidemic. If I see these pies with the slices that are from different countries, you see this plasmid here has been detected in different countries. Others have more regional expansion. This kind of plasmid is epidemic. So not only the bacterial clone can be epidemic, but also a molecules inside the bacterium can be epidemic. It's like that plasmid infect bacteria, bacteria infect us. And therefore, sometimes it was impossible to recognize a direct transmission of the same strain from a food to a human, but it was possible to identify the same plasmid within two different strains. The horizontal transmission has been demonstrated to play an important role in the transmission of antimicrobial resistance. I don't want that you learn by heart this, but I am so proud to have generated this wonderful circle. I printed it out on a t-shirt because this is the result of, this is a phylogeny tree of all plasmids in the PMLST database after 10 years of activities. There are so many plasmids in these records that we can finally have an idea of diversity. And like viruses, we have now a phylogeny tree, and we have some plasmids that are strongly linked to the dissemination of specific resistant genes. This is a typical paper of done with modern technology. It has been done by in Denmark by Hansen and colleagues. They have done correct bacterial typing, starting with MLST of the strains. They demonstrated that there were common strains, for instance, shared between human and broilers. There were some that were only in one species, others that were shared by more species. Then they applied the sequencing, and they compare the continent of this bacteria, and you see different recipient cells, the same plasmid, shared by dog and humans. So the companion animals, you know, have been demonstrated to play an important role as a reservoir of several resistant genes. In other cases, they observed, again, different recipient, but the same in human, turkey, and broiler sources. So more accurate is the bacterial typing, more precise is the answer. In this review, we are encountering some major plasmid lineages, like this one, that are frequently reported. We have plasmids demonstrated to be present in human, poultry, in turkey, in all these nations, all these recipient strains, including Salmonella paratyphi, Salmonella Newport, Salmonella Heidelberg, Salmonella Diffimurium, so means the same plasmid shared, but mostly the same thing, conferring the same resistant pattern, the same resistant gene. The same can be said for another gene. Changing the gene, it changes also the plasmid. But still, we have records now in the literature that reports clear sharing of plasmids in different containers, in different recipients. And this is more or less the maps that we can put down with the published literature. So there are some plasmids that were frequently reported in Europe, others that had a world spread. Very briefly, mobile colistin resistance. It was for sure a problem, a molecular problem. This gene conferring a decoration on the LPS confer resistance to colistin, which is the last resort when you have finished all the antibiotics, you go to colistin. And it's for sure an animal-linked problem because we have more isolates described to be resistant to colistin in animals than in humans. In this review, Poirel and colleague reported the diffusion of MCR1, which is the first colistin-resistant gene. MCR stands for mobile colistin resistance. So MCR1 was the first one reported, and this is the spread in humans, in animals, and both. So it has been linked to animals because colistin was for so long time used only for humans, animals, and now with the problem of antimicrobial resistance, it has been reimported also in as a human drug. In last year, we discovered a new mechanism of resistance for colistin that was called MCR4, but in our case, it was not possible to link the same from food and humans. And fortunately, we had very clear results, so no doubt. It was found in a Salmonella monophasic variant in pigs. It was found in E. coli from pigs affected by colibacillosis, but when we found Salmonella monophasic variant positive for this gene, these are the strains from the animal, the results clearly demonstrated that the human strains and the pig strains were different. Not always, but the gene was the same, but transferred on two different plasmids. So The plasmid from human, the plasmid from pig were different. So sometimes you can answer clearly that at least at the for the moment it's not said that MCR4 jumped into the human chain food, despite it was present in pigs. The same can be said for carbapenem. Carbapenem resistant for the moment is a problem in human beings, and very, very rarely it has been reported in animals and in food, very rarely. Beatrice Guerra is one of the few that described that, but when she was in German, but I really still believe that we can wait, but it can happen, of course. We will discuss next EFSA meeting. The most important thing is there are some genes that are so diffused that we can expect to see them jumping in the food chain. We can expect them because they have such a wide dissemination that it's still is possible, and it happened already. This spillover is expectable. And there is a plasmid I want to show you because it's very nice to see this example. The name is Incaseless C, associated with NDM. This is the distribution of this plasmid in the world in humans. These are the structure of the plasmid, the map. Red is a transposon, yellow is resistant genes. And this is, in 2010, this was isolated in the United States. It was very important plasmid because it conferred resistance to cephalosporins by the presence of CMY2. But not only. In this part of the plasmids, you see this plasmid can be selected by sulfonamides, can be selected by aminoglycosides, can be selected even by disinfectants. So it's not that you use beta-lactams that you select for this guy. You select for this guy also using other molecules. In 2011, in Japan, in Canada, this plasmid acquired the metallo beta-lactamase in this point of the plasmid. So an evolution, okay? An evolution in a bad way for us, because now it confers resistance also to carbapenems, and it acquired the 16S methylase. The 16S methylase methylates the ribosomal RNA, so you are resistant to all aminoglycosides. Yes, sorry. This plasmid has been described in Salmonella corvallis in this bird. This is a migratory bird, and we found a new gene, the phosphomycin resistant gene, conferring resistance to phosphomycin. Phosphomycin is not so common in Europe, and in fact, the Milvus migrans like to live in China, where this gene is very, very frequent, and pass the summer in Germany, where it was captured and the corvallis found. You see, there are no borders for the immigration of resistant genes. They can arrive from everywhere, even from through the wild birds. I conclude. Different histories, different stories, different things can give you the dimension of the problem. It's a microscopical problem. It's a molecular problem. Therefore, it's very difficult to be followed. We need a lot of accuracy. We need a lot of efforts, research efforts, wet lab efforts. And for sure, we have to follow not only strains, but also plasmids and horizontal transmission resistant genes. I have a group all done by women in Italy, Roma. These are so beautiful. Thank you.
Alessandra, thank you. If there are questions from the floor, please could you raise your hand, wave it around. Could I also ask if there were any questions submitted through the app that we can display?
Lisa.
Do we have a question here at the front? We have a question here. Again, if questioners could perhaps just announce who they are before they ask the question.
Hi, I'm Luisa Peixe from Porto, Portugal, and I enjoyed a lot your talk. It's very nice. But also you show that there is some overlapping in terms of clones or plasmids that you focus more on your presentation on humans and foods, where possibly food can take a really important place in terms of origin. Although it seems that really it is not so clear, no? Also you focus that we are not sure if really this is a matter of selection or on food production level, or if it is the role of other settings that are involved. What do you think could be the should be addressed in the next years in order to become more clear the possible contributions of other settings on the burden of the resistance, and really to become more clear if the food industry is a great player or is only a vehicle of the resistance that are really emerging in environment, in wild birds, as you show, because this is one of the issues that you are dealing this to really to be more become clear what is the role of the food production on all this problem.
It's a very difficult question for one reason, that it's easy to sterilize from a live in bacteria, not so easy to know the risk of naked DNA in this context. I don't believe that the trace of DNA in food can support a risk, because the natural transformation, I think, is really playing a minor role. What is important is in live animals, yes, in food production, less, but in farms, it's very, very important, because there are silent, not pathogenic strains that support the transmission. Silent because they are not pathogenic, so we don't follow, we don't trace them. But these are a good reservoir that can then be a problem, and there are so many examples about that. The problem to combat a plasmid instead of to combat a bacteria, live in bacteria, is enormous, because again, we have to trace a molecule that is inside bacteria, so we should take care of the phenotype more than on the recipient characteristics. Can be done, it has been suggested by EFSA, to monitor for population expressing resistance, independently if they are pathogenic or not for human beings. But just to know exactly the hidden part of colonized animals, for instance. I don't know if I...
Thank you. And we do have a question which you can see on the screen in front of you there. So questions from Jamie Aguilera. Are antimicrobial resistance genes that are not associated with mobile elements also a concern for horizontal spread of AMR?
This is what I said at the beginning. For acquired resistant genes, we need something to promote expression and replication. For other genes, I mean silent genes, they should be brought to the expression, because otherwise the true impact on antimicrobial resistance should be given by a phenotype sooner or later. But of course there are a lot of silent genes that are into the genome, that are not still expressed, that have been demonstrated to become a resistant gene. So there are potential resistant genes that are not still mobile, that could be tomorrow a gene, a mobilized gene. Thank you.
Thank you. And I have to, I think we have to move on. So I see there was a hand, but we will keep that for the panel discussion. So, thank you very much. So, we now move on to our last speaker before the coffee break. It's Dr. Thomas Berendonk, who is a professor of limnology and director of the Institute of Hydrobiology in the Faculty of Environmental Science at at the Technische Universität of Dresden. And he's also a spokesman for the water quality and quantity of water cycle at the Center for Advanced Water Research. And he's held a full professor position in Dresden since 2008. I should mention that unfortunately, Dr. Brendonk will have to leave us shortly after this talk, so he won't be available for the panel. So if there are questions, we will allow a little bit of extra time for questions so that we can get the most of his wisdom before he goes. Thomas, the floor is yours.
Yeah, thank you first of all for the invitation. I feel a bit of an exotic person, and I also want to thank my charming colleague that she introduced antibiotic resistance so nicely, so I can spare a few slides almost, but I think they amend each other quite nicely. So I'm more or less the water person now in this consortium of speakers, and I think especially this year has shown dramatically that water shortage is an issue we have to account for. This summer has for many of us in Europe shown what we have to do if we have a lack of water. And therefore, this topic of water reuse is one which becomes more and more important. And with that, of course, also the quality of our water and the water we want to reuse. And water reuse, what does this entail? This essentially means that we want to use wastewater to irrigate, because the good thing about wastewater is that it contains lots of nutrients in addition to the water, but also it contains pathogens and it contains resistant bacteria, and this is the link to my esteemed colleague. Maybe one step back is also to her talk, the motivation. Why are we now interested in resistances and in bacteria, and why do we study them in the environment, for example? This slide shows this quite nicely. Here to the right-hand side, you see the different antibiotics, and here you see a time axis. And you have these three different colors. That's the gray one, when the antibiotic was discovered, the introduction into the market, and the first resistance observed. And you see, especially for the new antibiotics, the time between introduction into the market and the observation of the first resistances has shortened dramatically. And this is something clinicians have observed, and we're very concerned, because this means that the doctor has a much lower option to treat you if you have a pathogen and he wants to kill that pathogen in your body. The other problem is that the revenue time for pharmaceutical companies is much lower, and therefore they invest less and less money into the development of new antibiotics. This has a bit become better because there has been lots of governmental investment into the development of new antibiotics. But we still have this problem here. And it's a dramatic problem. And clinicians have recently, not actually scientists, I think discussed this now for the last 10, 20 years, that these antibiotic resistant bacteria evolve, as was just presented, not only in clinics, but also in the environment. That's the only explanation how we can observe them as such a frequency in the clinics. And this data is pretty convincing, and I don't think anyone is really disputing this at the moment. Therefore, for us environmentalists, this means that in addition to our chemical contaminants, like, for example, contaminants or antibiotics are also contaminants in the environment, and they belong to the emerging contaminants, we have something which you would call a biological contaminant. And in earlier days, pathogens in the environment would have been biological contaminants, and now, in addition to that, we focus on resistance genes and resistant bacteria, which I refer to as ARG and ARB, antibiotic resistance genes and antibiotic resistant bacteria. And this is reiterates what I just said, that we have realized that we cannot focus on the processes just in the clinic. We need to include the environment, and it was already discussed, especially also animal welfare and farming, but also, for example, how we treat our water and what we do with our treated water. I don't like the word hotspots, but these are currently discussed as the environmental hotspots where we observe new antibiotic resistances. Now I'm here also to present essentially two networks which work on this topic. One is a Nereos cost action, and there's a work group two which links this uptake and translocation of organic microcontaminants and antibiotic resistant bacteria and their genes in crops, which is the link to this presentation here into this auditorium. And we want to understand the fate of antibiotic resistant bacteria within urban wastewater, soil, ground surface water, and crops. And these are two European funded projects where we work on this topic, and which I essentially am the vehicle to present this. So our primary objective in Nereos is a multidisciplinary network to determine which of the current challenges related to wastewater reuse are the most concerning ones, and for the environmental health protection, and how can we overcome these. It's a pretty strong challenge we face there, and one of the remarkable elements of this cost action is, as you can see here, I think it's the biggest cost action in terms of nations ever. And this also illustrates the big interest on this issue, especially concerning antibiotic resistance and especially the wastewater reuse. I focus here now on work group two, where the issue is the uptake and translocation of organic and microcontaminants on antibiotic resistant bacteria and genes in crops. You see there are many other work groups, but they are not so relevant for you. So the objective of this work group two is to especially consolidate the knowledge on the uptake and translocation of microcontaminants and resistant bacteria and genes in crops, because we don't really know very much about this so far. And we want to understand the main physiochemical characteristics which affect this uptake, and especially the translocation within the plant, for example. And of course, ideally, we want to develop a set of recommendations regarding the minimization of the biomagnification process. I think most of you know what that is, so the accumulation of the contaminant in essentially the food objective. Yeah, this is the crop. This is essentially that what we want to eat later. And we want to understand how the pharmaceuticals, for example, are distributed within this plant if you irrigate it with wastewater. For that, we focus on the root system, and we also focus where these different chemicals are allocated and what kind of different chemicals or bacteria or resistance genes are distributed, and what are the environmental characteristics which might further these processes or inhibit them. So what we found as sort of a result of as a review was that the potential of CEC, these are contaminants of emerging concern, are decreased in the order of leafy vegetables to root vegetables and to cereals and fodder crops and finally fruit vegetables, which was something which we did not quite expect, at least from our perspective. You might say, told you so, I don't know, but this is, at least for us, it was unexpected. But in general, it is very difficult to draw concrete conclusions on this effect. We just need more data from different plant growing methods and especially under controlled conditions and for many different plants and pharmaceuticals. This is similar to many other studies we also do, for example, on water quality. We do have results, but they are very fragmentary. They are just, you know, not strategic and not a overall picture is clearly presented in the scientific literature. And the uptake of CC, especially in fruit trees, has not been yet evaluated, which is surprising because they have a very high net irrigation requirement and evapotranspiration rates, I mean, especially, for example, here in Italy. And therefore, we believe they are high to moderate, should have a high to moderate CEC uptake. What we now also started to do within the answer concept, because we believe it's really necessary, is that field studies must be performed, especially under realistic agriculture conditions, because oftentimes laboratory results fall really short. And they must be examined in the edible parts of the plant and in the growing medium. And of course, there is a big lack of risk assessment concerning the irrigation of vegetables with wastewater, especially for chemicals, which what surprised us, because we sort of expected that for antibiotic resistant genes and bacteria, we were not so surprised, because this is a very difficult approach in itself, because the classical ecotoxicological methods don't really work there. And I will just quickly skip this because I have a shortage in time. And I just want to show you that this work group has come up with two deliverables concerning the chemical contaminant and biological contaminant. So first of all, we need to have a high frequency of detection in treated effluents for a micro contaminant to be relevant. And it should be traceable in the wastewater treatment process. It should be of environmental, agricultural, and health concern, and at least one of the following criteria should be met. The DT50 in the soil should relate to 2 weeks, and the phytotoxicity at the environmental should be at environmental relevant concentration, so what we actually find in the environment. And it should promote a selective pressure to soil microbiota and have potentially human health effects according with threshold contaminant concentration criteria. And then it should have a significant uptake rate by crops, and here are the bioconcentration factors which relate to what I said earlier. Why do we need these priorizations? Because when you listen to talks of chemists, I'm not a chemist myself, you see that they have a huge amount of different contaminants in the wastewater. It's really, it's hundreds to thousands, and some of them are easily detectable and some are very difficult to detect. And once they have to develop a detection technique, they find new CECs, and then they need to do this again. And therefore, it's really important that we prioritize. Otherwise, they will not be able to detect a suit of chemicals which can be important for rules or regulations later on. This is a bit simpler for the biological contaminations. Here we have focused on certain, or we're able to agree on certain antibiotic resistant bacteria and also genes. This was a long discussion because this were environmentalists, engineers, medical profession, and but there's certainly agreement that one of the first should be Escherichia coli and other gram negatives actually, like Klebsiella, and all these resistance genes here you have partly already heard in the talk before. And one of the criteria is, general criteria is, they are of clinical importance and they are mobile. present a few results on this ANSA project, which is an ITN project. Just a few first results. The main scientific objective, and I only refer to the wet one here, otherwise we would sit here another half an hour, is that we would like to understand the fate of the antibiotics, the antibiotic-resistant genes and bacteria within the wastewater treatment plant, the soil, surface water, and crops. We have chosen, this is one of the examples from Germany, where there is a water reuse in place. It's in Braunschweig. There, wastewater is irrigated to the fields, and the crops which grow from here go partly into biogas production, which then produces energy again for the wastewater treatment plant, but parts of it also goes into feed for animals, for example. But what's not allowed, at least in Germany, is that it can be directly used to plants for food. But nevertheless, it's an interesting case study which you can use there. And what we also analyzed is how this impacts the soil and the propagation towards the groundwater, which is our water resource. And I just want to show you this as an illustration how stable some of these things can be. This is now not genes, these are real bacteria. and what you also see is their percentage is here to the left-hand side. That's the percentage of resistant isolates of Escherichia coli. So for example, for ciprofloxacin, in the irrigation water, we have almost 20% resistant bacteria to this antibiotic. And you see that in the deeper you go into the soil, the percentage goes down. But for example, for sulfamethoxazole, this is not the case, which is for those people who work in this area not so surprising. But for example, in ampicillin, we also don't see a strong reduction. So all I want to show with this is that these resistant bacteria and even Enterococcus in soil, which is not really its natural habitat, can be quite persistent. Now, what does this mean for the irrigation and for what you are mostly interested in? Here we see also that these enteric pathogen survival, depending on what strains, can be quite persistent. This is a study by van der Linden. And if I just go one further on, if you see this, for example, on lettuce, you see this, they have done two repeats. They can also be quite stable. Sometimes they decrease, but it's certainly not a given that they will die on these leaves. And this is even the case if you do drip irrigation, so you don't do spray irrigation because you try to avoid, you know, dropping the water onto the plant. Even then, E. coli can be quite persistent. I mean, it's certainly decreasing, but it is still persistent over some time. And most recently, this is from a preprint. It's from a colleague of mine. What she did is she analyzed the resistant plasmids on salad. It's a salad you can buy in the market. And what they did is they first analyzed molecularly. They didn't find any plasmids on there, but then they put in a culture step of this market into sterile medium, and then they could detect plasmids which refer antibiotic resistance on these salad leaves. And side story, they found this more often in salads which are packed in plastic in supermarkets than in salads which you buy freshly. And there's a certain reason for that, and that is that oftentimes when you have salads washed very clearly, then the sort of natural flora on the leaf is destroyed and only a few bacteria are left, and also the resistant ones are left. And when the package is a very nice environment, so that then those ones which carrying a resistance seem to have a competitive advantage and therefore can multiply better. But this is just a side story, and this is something we currently investigate. And what we also currently investigate is this uptake of antibiotic resistant genes or bacteria in the plant. So do they actually also incorporate resistant bacteria, for example, in tomatoes, in the tomato fruit, in the vegetable itself? There are indications that this is the case. Yeah, with that, I've already finished. I would like to thank my group at home. That's my institute who helped a lot. And I thank you for listening.
Thank you, Thomas. And I see David in the front row is first out of the blocks with the questions. Can we have the microphone to the front row, please?
That's an excellent talk, and it ties in well with what she was saying at the Plasma Sans Frontières. And I was thinking about this in more global terms, and I was wondering if work had been done on, for instance, almonds in Southern California, which use billions of cubic meters of water every year. I don't know if they use surface water, but I know they've had problems with salmonella, and I'm not sure about the resistance. I don't know what the uptake would be in those.
I think this is something we just move into. We ourselves have just submitted a manuscript where we looked at the sewage of airplanes. And we found in the sewage of the airplanes the highest diversity of resistance genes, we used metagenomic methods for that, ever described. So there's certainly an effect of globalization as well. Yeah, definitely. I would believe so. In terms of irrigation, this depends very much. For example, we know that some companies are aware of this already. So, for example, if a German farmer produces potatoes for the Netherlands companies don't want that they irrigate their potatoes with river water. They have a contract that they use groundwater. So that shows that, you know, many are already much more aware of it than the scientists maybe even.
Thank you. So Ernesto had a question. Just while the microphone's going across to Ernesto, front row here, just to comment on the plain sewage, I don't find that finding surprising at all. I mean, there have been some published volunteer studies of people returning from various parts of the globe to Europe showing remarkably high fecal carriage rates of resistant bacteria, so that it's in the plain sewage is perhaps not so surprising. Ernesto.
Yes, Ernesto Liobana from EFSA. Thank you very much for your talk. It's a pity you will not be staying with us until the end.
Yes,
and that's why I wanted to get your views in a couple of things. I would like to hear whether you think we are ready right now with methodology to be applied for the quantification of resistance genes and resistance plasmids to be used in routine surveillance for reclaimed water. This is my first question. Then we heard from Alessandra and others that the pathways that the transmission of resistance genes take are really, really complicated, and therefore perhaps it's not that easy to have risk assessments. What is your view? Do you think we should really aim to have risk assessments, or we should be taking more a hazard approach? And if that is the case, I would also like to hear about what treatment options we have right now to be able to tackle this this problem, not focusing on the bacteria, but focusing on the genetic material. Thank you.
Thank you. So first of all, the questions, do we have the method to quantify? I would say yes. They may be not ideal. I think there's certainly room for improvement. But nevertheless, I think it's high, actually I think it's almost too late time that we quantify and have a monitoring system in place. Because otherwise, the biggest problem we have with many of these studies is that we can quantify it, and then we want to know, is this now more or less? And we cannot say it because we have no data where we can compare it to. So, and therefore, I think it's high time, and I think, for example, real-time qPCR of selected genes works well. Why not? Metagenomics might be another option, but I have a certain opinion on that, which others have another, but I'm sure there is one method we could use, and certainly it can be improved. The other question, I would propagate more an hazard approach. Risk assessment is very difficult. Mostly, as was described earlier, this is a very dynamic system. So you might detect a certain resistance genes in an environmental bacteria, and this environmental bacteria may not grow in your gut or whatever, but the transfer then might occur in your gut, and then it becomes a problem. And there are many other issues which make a risk assessment very difficult. Oh, treatment options, yes, of course. Certainly, I think if you use water for reuse, you definitely need to have at least a fourth stage treatment of the water. Definitely. Yeah. But this is also true, I think, from a purely hygienic view, not so much even antibiotic-resistant bacteria. You know, it comes both in place. But I would say this is a big discussion. We always ask what would be the threshold level, and I personally think we should aim at almost drinking water, and if not that, then certainly bathing water. There are regulations already in place. But this is a very pragmatic approach.
Thank you, Thomas. And I think we have a question from my co-chair.
Thank you. Thank you very much for an interesting presentation. In the EU, we are seeing more and more outbreaks related to food of non-animal origin.
Of animal origin.
Non-animal origin. Traditionally, the legislative efforts, the policy effort, have been put more on controlling food of animal origin than food of non-animal origin, but we see that now, as I said, the number of outbreaks is not yet at the level of the United States, but we see it slightly and constantly increasing. Also, we have seen this morning in a nutrition session that the new generations of young millennials and earlier ages, they tend to be more choosing diets of plant origin, plant-based diets, as vegetarians, vegans, paleo diets, all these diets. So for this, I could assume that the exposure from foods of non-animal origin would increase. So what is, in your opinion, the most important policy measures, intervention measures that should be implemented to kind of stop or stabilize the trend and not have the trend increasing? Thank you.
I mean, this is what I just meant to say I cannot say so much about how to work with food after the food production. It's just not my competence. But what I can clearly say is you need to control the water with which you irrigate your food very strongly. Yeah, and you need to have very strong regulations on that. Otherwise, you will contaminate your food. And this is obviously most non-animal food.
So, thank you. It's
can I just one?
Yes, of
sorry,
course.
One thing I would like to add is that if you, I can say that as well. If you control the food, you also always need to be aware of the non-viable part. Yeah. So if you cannot culture something on your food, it doesn't necessarily mean it's not there. You know, you need to incubate it for a while and then see if it grows later. I think this is a very important step. Sorry.
No, thank you. So thank you, Thomas. And can I say a big thank you to all of our speakers for keeping impeccably to time. It was a fantastic session. So we now have... we now have around 30 minutes coffee break. Could you please try and aim to be back promptly at 3:45? And while you're having your coffee, think of the questions that you want to post on the app so that we can have a lively panel discussion at the end. Thank you.